Stravinsky, The Rite of Spring on Columbia Records.
Pierre Boulez, folks, listen to this. Play Cart C1. Pierre Boulez's album, The Rites of Spring, spelled R-I-G-H-T-S, very subtle, is available at a special low price. No wonder, I tell myself. At all Corvette stores for only $3.87. Or you could get my album instead, but that's a matter of choice. Tonight at the Joint in the Woods, guess who's there? It's Ladies' Night. They won't like that. Woman's Night. Featuring the exciting 8-piece... all-female group, ISIS or Isis, depending where you come from. All females admitted at half price. Oh, good. Well, Bowie can get in. Also, dance and party with Lock, Stock and Barrel. That probably is a group because it's in inverted commas. Coming next Wednesday, October the 2nd, to the Joint in the Woods. Nothing like a joint in the woods, he says, losing his green card possibilities in one blow. T-Rex on Friday. Now, that's a good band. Now, he's by a couple of his records. He's getting fat with worry. On Friday, October the 4th, Martha Reeves. She's great. And Saturday, October the 5th, Buzzy Linhart. She's great, too. For more information, call. Get your little pencils ready. 201-335-9800. 9800. Joint in the Woods. Parsippany.
Yes.
Got it this well time. Done. Yeah. Sounds like a group. New Jersey. Where the stars shine. All right. We're not going to bother with the weather. Just look out of the window. Oh, you want the weather?
It's
the degrees have changed. Oh, this is a nice degree. The temperature's 69. Get it? Yeah. Humidity is 90%. Number 9. That's all right. Barometer 30.013. That's another 9. Inches and falling. Inches and falling. That sounds like a song. Wind southeast at 6. See, it's all 6 and 9s. Very deep, man. Very deep. The weather in Central Park is still there, and it's cloudy. Okay, that was UPI. We're only giving you one version of the weather, so you don't get confused.
John Lennon is our guest?
Yes, he is.
Or maybe it's the other way around.
Well, it depends. No, I think I'm the guest, because I'm sitting behind the thing. Yeah. Although I do have the sweeties.
But you brought the records along.
I brought 4 only. You know, I didn't know how you'd take it. I nearly brought 100, but, you know. I forget to play my own album. I'm so busy playing these old. This is another American record that nobody I know over here seems to have ever heard of it. And it's called Some Other Guy by Richie Barrett. There is a strange bootlegs of the Beatles singing it rather crappily from the cabin somewhere way back in 61. This is another what I call Son of What Did I Say, Son of Watch Your Step, Son of Lick Records. And this is a guy called Richie Barrett, who's also a songwriter. I think he's still around, but I don't know what he's doing. This is Some Other Guy. You'll notice the intro is slightly like Instant Karma. Every band in the world, are we on? No, yes. Mm-hmm. Every band in the world used to do that song. That was an album version. It wasn't the original single, which, as far as I know, was the first electric piano on record that I ever heard. And What Did I Say seemed to be the start of all the guitar lick records, because none of us had electric pianos, so we all did it on guitar to try and get that low sound. And before that, everything was mainly licks like you get on the Little Richard rock and roll records, like Lucille licks, where the sax section and the guitar played it. And What Did I Say started a whole ball game, which is still going now. And that's all I got to say about that. Dennis Elsas, you see, I got his last name from Roberta. You're listening, Roberta? She's making chocolate pudding, and I'm starving. All right.
In 1963 and 4 and 5, when the Stones were the group that was coming up hard and strong behind the Beatles, were you all friends?
Yeah, we went to see them at, I believe the place was called Crawdaddy in Richmond, and also, I think, another place in London. And they were run by a different guy then, Giorgio Gomelsky, who also discovered, brackets, you know, quotes, the, what's that group everybody goes for that Jeff Beck was in? I can't remember the name. One of those mid-60s English groups anyway, which I never thought were much cop except for Jeff Beck. Everybody went through the...
Yardbirds.
Yardbirds, that was it, Son of Stones, but they never really had a singer, you know, or a performer. And immediately we started hanging around London. The Stones were just up and coming in the clubs then. And we knew Giorgio through Epstein, and we went down and saw them and became good friends. And the story on how this song we're going to play, I Want to Be Your Man, which we virtually finished off in front of them because they needed a record. They'd put out Come On by Chuck Berry and they needed a quick follow-up. And we went down. We met Andrew Oldham, who used to work for us or used to work for Epstein. And he'd then gone with the Stones and probably got them off Giorgio Gomelsky. And he came to us and said, have you got a song for him? We said, sure. You know, and we thought, because we didn't really want it ourselves, which is one way of putting it. We went in and I remember teaching it to him, you know. And the whole story of it, which helped my memory of it, because it all fades away, is in that book on Mick, which Mick's not keen on. I understand that, but
Tony Scaduto book?
Yeah. But it's all right for people who they're not writing about those books. You know, if it was about me, I wouldn't like it probably either. But I must say, I raced through it for all the juicy bits like everybody else, right? And it's very interesting. I don't think it really harms him. You know, it shows that he knows what he's doing, which is cool. I don't think he did anything to Brian Jones either. So here's I Want to Be Your Man by the Stones themselves.
That's the only one that the two groups ever did.
Yeah, the only records we covered, I mean, that we both did the same. Yeah, they did it first. We did it with Ringo after. And that was it. That was the Stones' second single. I don't know what happened over here, but in England it was.
You're still in touch with them and you speak with them?
Yeah, I see. I know Mick's around now. I haven't seen him this trip, but last time I saw him was L.A. In fact, we were jamming together down in Record Plant West and we made quite a good track. I was so-called producing it, meaning sitting behind the desk. And
was there ever talk then, or is there talk now of the groups getting together and doing something?
We never talked about it because in the early days we just had our own careers to look after, and we hung around in two separate periods. One was when they were initially still playing in the clubs. I remember the first thing one of the members, Brian Jones, came over and said, are you playing a harmonica or a harp on Love Me Do? Because he didn't know how, he knew I got this bottom note and he suspected I said a harmonica, you know, with a button, which wasn't real funky blues, you know, if you're supposed, but you couldn't get Hey Baby licks on a blues harp. And we were also doing Hey Baby by Bruce Chanel at that time. And then the later period was when we were both sort of riding high and there was a discotheque scene in London, and the main club we all went to was the Ad Lib. There was a couple more, but they were never as big, Bag of Nails. But we used to just go in there and dance and talk music and generally get drunk and stoned and high. And one of the records we always played was in the Ad Lib itself, folks, with all of us sitting there listening and dancing, looking super stoned. And the record was called Daddy Rolling Stone by Derek Martin, which The Who later did a sort of version of, like the English usually do of these great records. Not too good. That's including us.
This was an American record.
Oh, yeah. Another great American record. That's all we ever played, American records. There's no such thing as English records those days. So here's Daddy Rolling Stone, Derek Martin on Sue Records, about 63 probably. I Want a Whopper.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, don't you? I love them things. Derek, I'm 5 pounds overweight and I want a Whopper, isn't that
Derek funny? Martin.
Yeah, Derek with a D-E-R-E-K. Daddy Rolling Stone, now you heard the real one for all you Who freaks.
We've got just 29 minutes left and about 8,000 questions. It went, yeah. our 2 hours or so have 8, gone quickly.
8,000 records to play, too.
Hmm. Is it easier to be a John Lennon celebrity in New York? Are people less apt to hassle you and bother you with things? Can you go about your life? Can you have dinner in a restaurant?
Oh, yeah. Well, there's no, that goes for L.A., Frisco, anywhere. I think people are a bit cooler in New York. And I've been here 3 years and people sort of will wave or something, or a taxi driver will say, oh, you know, are you still here? Or whatever, good luck and all that jazz about immigration.
Can we?
Yes, we can.
Yes. What about all that?
And so anyway, I do get, one of my biggest kicks is just going out to eat or going to the movies, you know, and doing things I couldn't do when I was, you know, in the middle of the Beatles stuff. And I really get off on that. And occasionally people ask for autograph or just want to shake hands is the coolest one that happens, which is cool with me. And I'm just known enough to keep my ego floating, but unknown enough to get around, which is nice.
You like New York?
I love it, you know, and that's why I'm fighting so much to stay here. so as I can be in New York. You know, maybe they could just ban me from Ohio or something. You know, nothing against Ohio.
What's the status? I mean, we saw photographs of you walking in and out of court buildings.
With my suit on.
Yes, you look very nice.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Well, every now and then, this is the way, as it appears to me, which is virtually like it appears to the public, because I don't follow it in detail unless the lawyer calls me, Leon Wiles, nice guy. Every now and then, I suddenly hear that I've got 30 days to get out of the country. Last time I was on the way to Record Plant, I was in a taxi. And the radio was on. I just heard it announced over the radio. So, being jocular, I said, drive me to the airport, Sam. And we were laughing about that. And apparently my lawyers hadn't told me because they didn't want to depress me in the middle of the album. But I got it over the airwaves instead. And they say you've got 30 days to get out. And then my lawyer appeals it. And that gives me another 6 months or something like that. And it goes round and round in circles. The last time I was in court was, I think the government had taken me to court for something or other, and our plea was, could we interview the prosecution counsel that had originally been the government's prosecution counsel and the head of immigration? Could we have them on the stand, you know, to examine them or whatever? But we were not granted that, you know, so we're not allowed to talk to their ex-lawyer, who's a nice guy and a straight guy, and he'd probably tell us the truth, you know. So somebody doesn't want us to interview them. But I seem to be still here, and I don't have any intentions of going. And I'd like to thank all the people that write to me, and because I don't usually answer, because I have no answer, you know, about how they can help. But one thing that does help, I think, A, the fact that you write to me is helpful, because it cheers me up when I think about it. And the other thing is, if you just write to your local senator or congressman, that keeps them in, it keeps the thing in their minds. And it isn't like, oh, he's already gone, what happened? Because senators and congressmen are a bit like advertisers. If they get a letter from one person, they reckon it represents 50 or 100. And it just reminds them when they're sitting over their cigars somewhere and the case occasionally comes up, they might think, oh, well, yeah, you know, my constituents wrote me a letter about that. So that's about the only way you could help.
Yeah, it was, you know, it was sad when Charlie Chaplin,
I know,
finally came back to America.
That's why I don't want to happen to me.
All those years, gosh.
I'd hate that, you know, they wheel me on at 60 and give me a plaque for yesterday and Paul wrote it, you know. I mean, I can just see it, you know. I don't want that. I'd like to live here, you know. I don't harm anybody. I've got a bit of a loud mouth, that's about all, you know. And I make a lot of music, and that's what mainly I do. I'm either making music, watching TV, or listening to the radio. And occasionally I get into a little spot of trouble, but nothing that's going to bring the country to pieces.
No, certainly
and,
not.
I think there's certainly room for an odd Lennon or two here.
I agree. I know everyone out there does too. We're sitting with the new album, and this is a track called...
Oh, this is a track called Scared, which means that the moment I was writing it, that's how I felt. But now I'm quite happy, thank you. Oh, that was Scared.
Scared.
Scared, yeah.
From Walls and Bridges.
Out soon or out now at all those record stores mentioned. Come on, Goody, put it in the window now. Well, let's not forget Harry Nilsson's Pussycats.
Let's hope so. Some commercials?
Yeah, why? You're going to put your own commercial on, aren't you? It must be funny putting your own. Well, it's like me here plugging me on records, right?
Hold on.